This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
Something you may or may not know about me, kind of depends on how long you've been following my work, is that for 31 years, I owned and operated a recording studio in Phoenix. It was called Lamb Chop Studios. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. The reason I tell you this is, and most people kind of jumped to the conclusion that we were recording bands and, you know, it was a music studio. And I originally started it to do jingles for advertising. I'd write them and produce them and so forth. But I quickly found out that there was more steady income in becoming a studio where you recorded voiceovers with announcers and actors and so forth. So over the years, there were a lot of celebrities that would come through Phoenix and recorded our studio for various reasons. And I got to know quite a few of them. Maybe my all-time favorite was Leslie Nielsen. And you probably think of him as the great kind of white-haired comic actor. When he was a young man, he was a dashing, dark-haired leading man, and I first saw him in the 1960s Disney series called The Swamp Fox, where he played a Revolutionary War hero by the name of Francis Marion. And he rode a horse, and I knew that he had that background as a Hollywood actor, riding and all of that. So one day, I asked him if he would do an interview with me for my radio show, and he graciously consented, and every year I bring it back. And because it's just one of my favorite things. He's just such a great guy. Unfortunately, Leslie Nielsen passed away in 2010, and we do miss him terribly. But this is something that I can offer you every year in remembrance of him. Towards the end of our show today, you're going to hear one of the early interviews I did with Mr. Pat Parelli of Parelli Natural Horsemanship fame. This was back in the year 2000 at the expo called Equitana in Louisville. It's no longer on here in the States. It still exists in other parts of the world. But it was one of the first times I sat down and talked to Pat about his vision for this natural horsemanship movement. And it's very interesting to hear those early thoughts of this man. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. And we'll be back. EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Parelli.
And I'm Linda Parelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD TV.
RFD TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Parelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD TV and Parelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
For 60 years, the United States Pony Club has been developing character, leadership, confidence, and a sense of community in youth through a program that teaches the care of horses and ponies, riding, and mounted sports. Red Brand Fence is proud to support these initiatives as the official education sponsor of Pony Club. Through Red Brand's Fence 101 curriculum, Pony Club members can learn correct selection and installation of fence, helping to keep their horses and ponies safe and secure. Learn more by clicking on the Pony Club button at redbrand.com.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention The Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention The Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com.
Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
And now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Thank you very much. We are back, everybody. This is Rick Lamb coming to you live from Equitana USA 2001 with the Horse Show, courtesy of Horse and Rider Magazine and Equisearch.com. My guest is Pat Parelli. Pat, welcome.
Hey, Rick, how you going?
Just great. You have had a great show here. Capacity crowds everywhere you go. Do you ever get tired of that?
Oh, Rick. So, you know, if I didn't have capacity crowds, I'd get tired of that. No, this is a very, very exciting thing because this is my passion. And I think it takes four things to really be good at anything, and it takes passion, instinct, intellect, and experience. And now, you know, I've been doing this for 19 years. I feel like I'm starting to get the experience to be able to really utilize my talents. I'm very, very excited.
Well, I know the crowd always gets very excited. We were sitting not 20 yards away from your demonstration yesterday trying to conduct interviews, and the crowd response was so enormous that we were shouting here 2 feet away from each other,
right?
Just to be able to hear. So we've got a little bit more sedate crowd in the background today. Tell me about, let's just look ahead for a moment and then we'll talk about some of the other things you've been doing. 2002, Success with Horses Seminars. What's that all about?
Well, this is a new seminar that we've come up with. You know, we've been going around the world for the last 6 years doing what we call a savvy seminar, which is basically designed to get people to say, wow. Because as soon as people say, wow, the next thing they want to know is how. Well, we experimented with this in Australia this year, and it was a wild success. 2-day-long program. And we start off, like we do our other seminars, with our savvy team, our best students in the area, showcase what they can do. Then, what we did over the next 2 days, we took a horse that had never been ridden, and we started him. A little bit in the morning on that day, a little bit in the afternoon, and a little bit the next day, so you can see the progression. We took a horse that a veterinarian had been asked to put down because of behavior problem. For somebody to make a decision to put a horse down, to give him the death sentence just because of his behavior, that's an extreme thing for me. So that was very exciting.
Plus, what was the outcome of that?
It was great. We had a horse that, a little black Arabian horse, that in 45 minutes, he was so smart, he was doing almost more than some of our horses on the savvy team.
I know you had mentioned that about Arabians, that you felt that they were getting a little bit of a bad reputation for being hot or too spirited, but you felt that was from their exceptional intelligence.
Absolutely. You know, a lot of people say Arabians are crazy, and you know what it amounts to is Arabians are sensitive, they're intelligent, and they require a lot more savvy driver. You know, it'd be like buying a Ferrari versus a Chevrolet. So we'll do that at our Success with Horses. The other thing we did is we brought in some sports figures that have been using my program. In Australia, we used a gal that has been the top in the last 20 years in the jumping field. And she had been introduced 3 months prior to our program because she had a horse that wouldn't jump anymore. They couldn't even ride it at home anymore. One of my instructors took the horse for 3 weeks, came back. The horse followed him through the jump course at Liberty, and he got on the horse and rode the horse with just a halter and jumped the whole thing in a Western saddle. So we used her. Then we also had a whole section on sports psychology, how to apply natural horsemanship to racing, jumping, cutting, dressage, reining. Been talking to David O'Connor. He's now starting to use parts of our program. And, of course,
he's a gold medal eventer.
Represented the USA and won the individual gold medal. He might even be there. We've been some talk of that.
Well, before we leave that topic, I heard a story I'd like you to relate about him riding Casper.
Well, David O'Connor came to one of our seminars in Ocala, Florida. And he came up and introduced himself, and I said, hang on a second. And I was signing signatures. I said, I've always wanted to meet you. I said, can you come over to the motorhome after we're done? He said, oh, yeah. So we did, and got acquainted, and you know, sat down and had a nice visit. So we went over and played with one of his horses that morning. Then we went to dinner that night, and we went to dinner with an old friend of mine, Mark Phillips, Captain Mark Phillips, who's a gold medalist himself and the Olympic coach for the U.S. So we all went to dinner, and we got kind of in a bit of a heated argument about dressage and pee off and passage. And I said, wait a minute. I said, if I can bring you over to my house tomorrow morning and show you a quarter horse stallion that can do the pee off at liberty, nobody touching him, nothing, just do it right there, stand still, and do the pee off. I said, then can we end the argument? Let's go home. I said, okay. So we all got up, 7 o'clock, played around with some horses and stuff. I showed him some things, and I said, David, come here. I want you to get on this horse. David got on the horse, and he picked up the rein and turned to the right, and he went, whoa, wait a minute. I have never felt anything like this. He had to take 3 steps. He said, I don't have to do anything else. I know the difference now. And that was pretty exciting.
Now, what I heard also, and maybe this was another part of the same encounter there with this particular horse, is you told him, don't give this horse any cues and think, walk, trot,
yes,
canter.
Yes, absolutely. That's it. What I try to do is get people to realize that the horse is so conscious of such little things. He didn't have to use his legs to go. He didn't have to use his reins to stop. It's just, I said, now just make a connection and now start to feel it, to think it. And he was blown away. He was so excited. And on the end of the story, he got on my other stallion, rode him bridleless and bareback, did a slide stop and a set of spins each way. Then I sent him one of my top apprentices from England. And she came and worked with him for about a month. And he called me up after. He says, I didn't even know people like this existed, that people that had this much skills that could be proper grooms and assistants for high-level people. So we got, I think, an exciting relationship.
Well, that's a great ambassador to a whole nother world that maybe has not been familiar with Parelli Natural Horsemanship.
Absolutely. I think, you know, in the last 19 years, I've been focusing in on the recreational market. People that just, you know, love their horses and want safety first, fun second. I'll try a little bit of excellence. Well,
if it's convenient.
If it's going to be, yeah. But, you know, the sporting world, the big five, racing, jumping, cutting, reining, and dressage, the big five, you know, haven't really looked at us very strongly and stuff, and we haven't represented ourselves to them very strongly either. But lately we've been focusing in on that. I started off as a competitor. I've been involved with reining horses, cutting horses, reining cow horses for the last 25 years. Been involved in 3-day eventing and dressage. And now, all of a sudden, out of the woodwork, David O'Connor gets interested in our program. Leon Harrell is now,
cutting.
One of the first humans to win over $1 million riding cutting horse, now wants to join my program. Bobby Frankel, who won the Thoroughbred Breeders, that won the Citation Award this year, won $11 million and second at the Kentucky Derby last year, is trialing our program. And the world's largest standard bed farm, the Hanover Horseshoe Farm out in Pennsylvania, Jim Simpson came and spent 2 days with us last week.
And those are harness racing horses.
And those are harness racing horses. And he wants to trial with his yearlings for the next 2 to 3 years, a certain percentage of them, to do completely a P&H program, natural horsemanship. And I'm going to send some staff. We're going to develop a program and give it a 3-year trial.
We will have more of Pat Parelli from Equitana when the horse show continues. We'll hear about his special appearance there with John Lyons and Monty Roberts and about the Tom Dorrance benefit in Fort Worth. Stay with us. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Welcome back to the Horse Show, everybody. I'm Rick Lamb. At Equitana, I had the pleasure of moderating a special roundtable discussion with Pat Parelli and some other distinguished gentlemen. We had in one room at one table. It wasn't round like we thought it was going to be, as you pointed out. But we had you, Pat Parelli, John Lyons, and Monty Roberts all at the same table answering questions. How was that?
Well, first of all, it was a momentous occasion. It was the first of. And I was proud to be sitting there and amongst a group of men that are thought of as highly as those two. And I thought it was quite interesting and exciting. You know, people were able to ask in an open forum any question they wanted. The interesting thing, I think, was the unity of answers that came across rather than the huge differences that people, I think, were maybe expecting. You know, because in order for this to work, it takes philosophy, concept, theories, then details. And when, you know, I think where everybody realizes the same philosophies and concepts were pretty well on track, the theories here or there, or the details here or there, maybe were a few little nuances were, but it was very, very interesting afternoon.
Well, I agree 100% with you that the substance of what was being presented was unified, I felt, pretty much throughout. Style was the main thing that I saw that was different, and it was an opportunity for everybody to kind of do their thing, everybody to enjoy it. And I thought it was a wonderful event, and I hope we can do some more of those in the future.
Yeah, and I would really be willing, you know, to help promote that, because natural horsemanship now has become a well-recognized, standalone, multi-million-dollar industry worldwide. If we all believe that natural horsemanship is best for the horse, best for humans, best for the industry, then what's best for all of that is that we get together and create synergism rather than separatism.
Well, I think another good example of that was an event that you took part in that was another sort of a momentous occasion, the benefit for Tom Dorrance, and I'd like you to talk a little bit about that.
That, I gotta admit, is probably one of the greatest honors that I've ever had, to be invited to the Tom Dorrance benefit. Ray Hunt and his wife Carolyn hosted this. It was a great honor to Tom to honor all of his attributes and all his contributions to the horse industry, to the horse world, to horse people. But the other thing was great was the whole synergism of all these people coming together. And most of these people gave clinics. There were 1,000 spectators. There were 64 clinicians, most of which, all of us are so busy, we never ever see each other except for in a few airports once in a while. And for everybody to be there at once, this was a fabulous thing. There was only one thing I had a problem with there, and that was the day afterwards, my cheeks hurt so bad. I was smiling so much for the 2 days I was there that I actually had a jaw ache or a cheek ache somehow from smiling so much. So that was my only complaint.
I thought you were going to say from talking too much, and I said, oh, I think you've had plenty of practice at that.
Yeah. That was the first time. See, I didn't really do much talking there. I let Mr. Hunt have the microphone there.
Well, let's drop a few names. Ray Hunt. Buck Brannaman?
Ray Hunt, Buck Brannaman, Craig Cameron was there, Brad Cameron, the guy with the mules. He did a fabulous job. My teacher, Ronnie Willis, was there.
Let's go back and put this in perspective. Some people don't know who Tom Dorrance is, or maybe they've heard of him, but he is probably, along with his brother Bill, who passed away not too terribly long ago, the fathers of natural horsemanship in America.
As we know it, yes, absolutely. Tom and Bill, their older brother Pete, who passed away just before Bill, The Dorrance brothers came out of kind of northeastern Oregon, and I asked Tom one time, and he said, "Well, heck, that's what my grandfather did." In other words, what I got from that was that there's two ways to do things with horses. Always, there always has been a natural way and a normal way, and it's normal for horses to push, and it's normal for people to pull, but it's natural or supremely natural for them to be in unity, and this has been Tom's message, and.
It's also the name of his book, I believe.
Yeah, that's True Unity. He taught. He was the teacher of Ray Hunt, and an interesting thing happened. They had a student named Ronnie Willis, and I met Tom Dorrance, Ray Hunt, and Ronnie Willis on the same day. I was in Fresno, California, at a California Livestock Symposium. I was doing a bridleless demonstration on a mule, doing a cow working demonstration. Ray Hunt did the greatest colt starting demonstration I've ever seen in my life on that day. And afterwards, went over to the coffee shop, a little snack bar or something there. Standing one in line was Ron Willis, Ray Hunt, Tom Dorrance, and their wives. All standing there, I introduced myself. Met all three of them at exactly the same moment. Ronnie Willis made sure that I got the message through my thick skull what Tom and Ray meant. I knew what they said, but I didn't really know what they meant. And he really was the person that camped with me and camped on me and made sure I got the message. And I hadn't seen Ronnie for 14 years. He had a really bad bout with diabetes, almost lost his life, completely got out of the horse thing. 2 years ago, I ran into him in Yuma, Arizona, showed him what I was doing on videotape. A huge tear came to his eye when he saw Silke in that from Germany in the wheelchair with her 1,600-pound Friesian. And he said, I can't tell you how proud I am. We've become reacquainted, good friends again. Ronnie just came to work for us in our new ranch up in Dillon, Montana. We have an 86,000-acre ranch right next to Ted Turner's on one side, Matador Ranch on the other. My partner, William Kriegel, bought the ranch, and I'm in partners on the horse operation there. Ronnie's up there with six of my top apprentices, and we have got a unbelievable horse, cow, and hay operation going in Dillon, Montana now.
Sounds like heaven. A little bit of heaven
in
Montana.
Pretty close.
Well, I have to, you know, you talk about communication, and knowing and being able to explain are two different things. And I think that, you know, the thing that you have going for you that people just react so positively to is the ability not only to explain in ways that people can really understand, but also to excite them and give them hope and the belief that they can actually get out and do it. So I compliment you. I think that's what your true talent is.
Thank you.
Obviously, you've got the horse ability. A lot of people in our industry do, but they can't all explain it as well as Pat Parelli. Right.
Well, my mom said early on, she said, "Son, you got the gift of gab. And if you don't turn that gift of gab into gold, it's just going to be pure BS. So you better do something about it."
Well, always a pleasure to have you on the show, Pat. Enjoyed seeing you here at Equitana USA 2001. I'm sure we'll meet up many more times down the trail. The website, if you would like more information about what's going on with Parelli Natural Horsemanship, is www.parelli.com. And by the way, I'll tell you something funny. Whenever I email anybody at your office, you know what my spell checker always tries to substitute for Parelli?
What's that?
Parolee.
Parolee, is that right?
Pat, thanks.
Well, Rick, if I don't see you in the future, I'll see you in the pasture.
You had to get that in, didn't you?
Absolutely.
Still to come, whether he's a swashbuckler, a buffoon, or a kindly storyteller, people love actor Leslie Nielsen. When the horse show continues, he'll talk to me about his life, his career, and his love of horses. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world, like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Parellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
You may remember him best as the rather bumbling Lieutenant Frank Drebin of police squad fame, but I remember him from when I was very young, astride a horse playing a swashbuckling Revolutionary War hero called the Swamp Fox, Francis Marion. Those are merely two characters that live within this very accomplished actor, and I'm very pleased to have him in the studio with me today, Mr. Leslie Nielsen. Leslie, welcome.
You were very young?
I was actually very young? Well, it wasn't that.
What are you implying by? Do you know that I play villains? I've done hitmen. Be very careful with me.
Well, I was going to ask you how much of these characters lie within you, but I don't know if I want to know the answer if you played hitmen.
The interesting thing is that you can't play anything that's not part of you.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean that it's a reality with you. You know, you may be cruel and vicious and sadistic. That may be also, you know, everybody has that as part of their nature, but some people use it.
Is that kind of an escape? Are you able to get some of that out of your system?
You know, I suppose it could be therapeutic because they've often used dramatic or drama situations in actual, psychology or group therapy, whatever,
yeah,
to get rid of those feelings and
acting out.
You act it out, and that's part of the acting, For acting is fundamentally the search we all go through, no matter what we're doing, and that is to find out who we are and whether we can show it.
Well, I know lots of actors. My wife happens to be an actress, and some of them have almost no personality. Once they're not doing a role,
that's a fine thing to say about your wife.
I don't mean her.
Oh, I see.
And I was going to say this was a compliment for you because you have such a personality when you're not on camera or when you're not performing. Do you ever have a chance to just be Leslie Nielsen in a role?
I don't know. I would. That would be my fondest wish, that I would be able to be Leslie Nielsen. It's so hard because I don't think that we necessarily know who we are. Sometimes we do, but even when we do know who we are and how we're feeling, we find it very difficult to express those that information to anybody. Maybe a very close friend you might do. But if you have the courage to reveal yourself, which is the essence of acting, to reveal yourself, if you have that courage, then you're in for some less stormy seas, put it that way.
When I first saw you, and we won't talk about how long ago that was. I'm talking about the Swamp Fox era. You were the leading man. You were the hero. And you were riding a horse throughout that. Since this is a show about horses, I suppose we should get a little bit of that in.
It was an American saddlebred.
Was it really?
Yeah, it was a stallion then too, and the double horse for that was another black horse that Casey Tibbs. That was his horse, and that horse would go 40, 45 miles an hour.
Wow.
It really ran, yeah. And I remember that Rex was the name of the beautiful black American saddlebred horse. He couldn't run. They're not bred for running. But he was five-gated, and you could throw him into a rack or God knows what, you know. He was like sitting in a rocking chair. But we came out to do this work and had a lot of the people out in which is now Sherwood Forest, Westlake Village. And
is this in the Los Angeles
area? In the Los Angeles area. And he was well-trained, but now he's around a lot of other horses, a lot more horses, and he started to feel his oats, so to speak.
Yeah, well, a stallion.
I felt I was sitting on a box of dynamite, ready to explode. Really.
Powder keg, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, how often did they bring in a double for you and a double for the horse?
Well, any time that there was a dangerous stunt to be done, mm-hmm. They would not take any chances on my doing it. I remember my double, I'm wearing the Continental uniform, and I'm being pursued by the British, and we're going across the swamps. There were kind of water in that area, and the horse hit a pocket underneath the water, bango, and over, head over heels, and the double, bango, he's into the drink. And I'm standing later on that afternoon with Fred Guest, who was the head wrangler. He was about 6'6", thin and gnarled and weather-beaten, just a real cowboy. Mm-hmm. And now I'm riding in my Swamp Fox outfit, and I'm going through the swamp again, being pursued. And we get to a bank on the other side, and the horse is going up. And, boy, the horse can't make it. The horse goes straight up and back over.
With you
falls
on
backwards.
It?
No, I wasn't on it.
Oh, okay.
So, bango. So that doubles in the drink again. And Fred and Guess is up there, you know, and he's sort of chewing on his tobacco. And he says, yes, sir. He's sure getting to be a clown, ain't he?
Well, did you ever take any spills?
No spill. I'm known for one of the most famous dismounts.
Really?
As Francis Marion. I rode up to the log cabin because I knew something had taken place and my loved ones were in danger and maybe they had been killed. And I rode up and I had to get off my horse and run into that cabin, you know. Now, when you get off a horse, before you can run, you have to get your foot out of the stirrup. And I started to run with my foot still in the stirrup. So, yeah, I took the fall then.
Oh, boy.
I've had both my daughters. I had my young daughter. They are both, you know, superior riders and hunter-jumper equitation. And my oldest daughter has a ranch up in Sheridan, Wyoming, and she does cutting horses. And she's really into ranching and into horses. But I've seen, and Mora, I've seen, she got kicked in the chest, and it was very serious. I didn't realize how serious it was. But she came through that okay, and another time the horse stumbled, and she went down, and then the horse proceeded to roll over her as it fell. And I thought, if anything has happened to my daughter, this is the time it is. That, you know, I was stunned. And you're not supposed to run out in a horse show. You know, you're supposed to. I couldn't. I no way. I was going to stand still. I was out there, and there she is. And she opened her eyes and she says, "Boy, that was close, wasn't it?" And so they picked her up gently, and I couldn't believe that she had escaped.
No broken bone.
Nothing.
Going back to the Swamp Fox era, how much was it expected for an actor in Hollywood to be a horseman back then?
It wasn't expected.
It wasn't?
It was just part of your own pride and thing. I loved riding horses. I loved sitting on a horse. I just loved the feeling. And And I love going out. And I think perhaps that's what Thea and Maura, my two daughters, inherited, perhaps, or whatever. Maybe it's horse riding genes or whatever. But it's exhilarating, and it's a pleasure, and it's a pleasure to get to know the horse. My oldest daughter does the horse whispering, and she trains and teaches. And she went through that period of astonishment when she found out how accurate and how right it was. Mm-hmm. And you know, you can't do that kind of thing with an animal where you don't have the bond of understanding of a mutual language. But there is a language, and the horse understands it, and so do you if you learn the technique. And there's a reciprocity that is remarkable that lends itself to the way you deal with everything in life.
Well, there's a very famous saying, and I think it was it's been attributed to Winston Churchill: "Nothing is so good for the inside of a man as the outside of a horse."
And very good, yeah.
I think there's a tremendous truth to that. More of the wackiness and wisdom of the one and only Leslie Nielsen when the horse show continues. We'll hear about the ice helmet, his whoopee cushion, and men with brooms. I guarantee you, you do not want to miss this. Stay with us.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again. You know, a lot of people think that if you have horses, you have to put up with flies, or you have to install big spray systems or deal with stinky traps or messy tapes. Not true. You can use Spalding Fly Predators, tiny, safe, easy-to-use, and inexpensive beneficial insects that kill flies before they emerge and become a problem. Do like I did and find out more about Spalding Fly Predators. Visit flypredators.net or call 1-888-282-7262. That's 1-888-282-7262.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition.
Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need.
Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
Actually, to be honest, we really don't care if they are your friends. Just tell people about the show. We'll keep putting it out every week. You get the word out. That's your job. My guest is actor, comedian, philosopher, and horseman, Leslie Nielsen. You grew up in Canada, and not just Canada, but North Canada, nearly to the Arctic Circle.
My father was a Mountie, and he was stationed at a place called Fort Norman, and that's just a shade south of the Arctic Circle. And I went up there as a babe in arms. We had to wait for the river, the ice on the Mackenzie River, to melt, so that the only way to get up there would be by launch. And it was a Hudson's Bay Company trading post, is what it was. And that's where I learned to walk. That's where I got my bow legs. We didn't have fresh food, and I got rickets. And but I was moving all the time. And so my little bones bent. And I used to hide the fact that I came from that small towns, and I wanted to be from the city. You know, I wanted people to know that I was a modern child, a modern young man, or whatever, modern, you know. And when I look back on it now, I'm so ever grateful that I spent my early formative years in small towns. One was a place called Thorhill, north of Edmonton, had 75 people. I counted them. And it's restrictive, but it's wonderful. If anything happens, everybody gets together to help. And there's a kind of a reciprocity and a feeling about people that grows from that.
Now, that far north, you had some pretty serious winters to contend with.
Oh, yeah.
Tell me about riding in the extreme cold.
Well, you don't. You're in the very extreme cold. Well, yeah, but you have to be far enough south. They now have horses up in the north, but in those days they didn't. You couldn't feed them. You know, how would you pack the hay? And there's no hay. There's tundra. And pine needles, and horses don't like pine needles. So, but when you get south into the rich, you know, farm country, then it was everything was horse and wagon. You had very few automobiles. Maybe one a week might come through the town of Thorhild. But I remember even in Edmonton, which was a big city, going to school, and I rode my bicycle. And I remember this particular morning, they announced on the radio before I left. It was 64 below zero.
Wow.
Which means it was 96 degrees below freezing.
Gee.
And it never occurred to, we figured, well, that must be how it is all around the world, you know, those kind of things.
Now, what did it feel like walking outside with it that cold?
You could have instant freezing, so you had to really make sure that you were covered.
Your whole body, you had to cover up your nose
eyes. You know, I had discovered in high school, in those days, something called a girl. Now, you know, if you could put a helmet on and with those ear flaps, what could look more unattractive than a helmet, you know, with the fuzzy ear flaps? You can't wear that. And also the long underwear. In school, your pants would hike up, and they could see the white underwear, and you didn't do that. You were tougher than that. So there you are, without a helmet, and with no long underwear on. You're going to deliver papers when you get out of school, and you've combed your hair because you're going to have to leave now, and they're going to see you, and you've got your hair all wetted down from combing it, and you walk outside and you go, and you have a helmet. It's an ice helmet. It's frozen onto your head. And you put earmuffs on then to keep your ears warm. The earmuffs did the job, but then you'd have to be patting yourself all the time to make sure that your nose and everything was staying reasonably warm, you know, to face the elements.
I imagine it's just something you get used to. I mean, that's life. You probably, like you say, you probably don't think it's any different for anybody else.
It never occurred to us.
Yeah. When did you make the transition from being like the serious leading man to comedy?
I've always, you know, gone for the laughs in my life. I just couldn't do it when I was acting because drama was a refuge, and I was frightened by standing up and ever indicating I could laugh or make anybody else laugh.
Is comedy harder for you than serious?
Well, it was harder for me to get up and do it, but once I started to do it, and then eventually I found out I could do it, and eventually, you know, when somebody would laugh before, I think, well, they were just being nice or whatever, but no, now I'm freer.
Is that more satisfying for you than somebody that would be moved to tears or emotion from a dramatic performance?
Well, if you're trying to do anything, if you move somebody to tears, that is very satisfying. But if you're telling something or doing something that's funny and people break up and they're laughing, that's the same thing. It's very sad. It's communication.
Let's talk a little bit about the Police Squad series.
Yeah.
That was not only funny. I mean, you created a character there that was really kind of you charted new territory in bumblingness. Was that a difficult character for you to play?
No, that's
play?
Me.
I'm
nothing more than a mass of imperfections, and I've accepted that fact. But for the longest time, especially the first year or so, I've always felt that I was a Renaissance man, and that I, could carry on witty conversation, and I could be amusing, and sometimes very insightful and intelligent, and that I was quite a commendable companion. And this dumb, stupid Frank Drebin, I would leave in the studio when I went home. But unbeknownst to me, I discovered one day that Frank was not in the studio. He had always been coming home with me. He was sleeping in the same bed with me, Frank Drebin was. And finally, I had to accept the fact that I really am as dumb and stupid as he is. So, which is very helpful because that's all I show.
He's living in there with the Francis Marions and the Mr. Magoos and all the other characters. Whoopee cushions.
Yes. What would you like to know?
You are known, and I don't know if you do this anymore. You haven't done it any time you've been at our studio, at least that I know of, but you used to carry around with you a little device.
I sometimes forget. Today,
You forgot to bring it? Darn.
Yeah.
But it was not a true whoopee cushion. It was some kind of a device that made that sort of a sound, though, correct?
It was like a small bellows.
Yeah.
It was just a little thing that you made, and when you squeezed it from one side to the other, it had an opening that you had on the palm of your hand, and it would make those wonderful rude noises.
Yes. Well,
just like
very
that.
Good.
That like that.
So you don't even need it.
You got it with you all the time. Yeah.
Well, the funny story that I have with that, and we were talking about this earlier, my wife, in her acting career, was once called upon to be an offstage announcer for a local TV show. And the host of the show was a gentleman who's now a very successful game show host in Hollywood by the name of Pat Finn. And at that time, on the NBC affiliate here in Phoenix, he was the weatherman. And he was a very young man trying very hard to make his mark. And this was his big moment. He had Leslie Nielsen on as a guest on the show that they had there. And you sat down and began a serious conversation with him, and then released a few of these sounds. And, of course, everybody else there knew what was going on except for Pat. He didn't know.
Yeah.
And he didn't know whether to acknowledge the noise or to ignore it. But he got redder and redder.
But that's one. The thing is, I don't recall the incident, but I...
Too many of them like that,
well,
I'm
no,
sure.
But, the one, it's good not to be able to recall it because it meant that he weathered the storm.
Yeah.
And that he did not do something that... because sometimes the reaction can be severe. And
tell me an example.
People can be... I remember working on a sitcom. It was a comedy, and... And the audience was being warmed up or something, and I went out and I stepped up and I did something quick and then used the whoopee cushion. And as I was coming back, the young guy who was the lead in the show, he said, "We don't do that on my show." And I said, Now I'm walking backstage. We're about to go on the air in 2 minutes, and we're doing a comedy. And he has just said, "We don't do that on my show." I thought, where is that man's head that he could do something like that? So
He was worried that you would do it
No, he was being extraordinarily possessive.
Oh, I see.
And unforgiving about anything that offended him.
You probably got a bigger laugh than he did.
I got a pretty good laugh. Actually, yeah. I've noticed it with comedians. I remember one comedian. I was fooling around, and by the time I had finished with using the whoopee machine, he was talking faster and louder and telling filthier jokes. And that was his defense. He was trying to defend against something that you cannot defend against. If I could get a dollar for every laugh I've had, I'd be a wealthy, wealthy man.
Well, you probably could have marketed that thing, Leslie Nielsen.
Really, you believe it or not, in Oklahoma City, The Duffy Martin, Jack Martin clan out there, the Martin, they began that 40 years ago, maybe 45 years ago, and they're still doing it and still having fun, still laughing.
Well, you've certainly brought a lot of laughs to all of us, and it's been a joy getting to know you a little bit here in our studios in Phoenix as you have continued with Katie and Orby, your series for Canadian television. Give us just a little quick synopsis of what Katie and Orby's all about.
Well, it's really about preschool children. I mean, anywhere from 3 to 6 or 7, but it goes older than that, too, whoever wants to sit down and watch. But I find that I've seen it happen with a couple of kids that they become glued to the television set. They just are totally absorbed by it. And it has to do with firsts. The first time you saw a fire engine, the first time you saw a turtle, the first time you turned a somersault, the first time you went to a museum, and the first time you came up against somebody who was really mad and really angry with you and was yelling, and what do you do? And so it's, you know, things that are first for little kids and gives them some idea of what to expect and what they might do or what happened with Katie and Orby or as they learn their little lessons. And it's turned out to be a wonderfully gentle, educative show.
Is it... Are you, this sounds a little pop psychology here, but does it put you in touch with the inner child, or the child part of you?
I ain't never have lost touch with my inner child.
Really?
No, I hope not. My phrase is, I don't want to grow up, I want to grow down.
What will we see in the coming year?
I have a new film that'll be coming out called Men with Brooms, which I did just recently up in Canada. It's about the life and loves and the drama and the sadnesses in a small town in Canada set against the background of curling. That's where the men with brooms, because in
And this curling, isn't like curling iron fixing your hair. This is the sport
this is,
known
this is
as
the sport of throwing
curling,
that big
yes.
granite rock down the sheet of ice to stop on a target.
And those in the northern part of the U.S. would probably know this better than those of us in the south.
Yes, yeah.
But
you can be sure curling is going to get to Phoenix.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's too interesting a sport.
Well, sir, it's been a pleasure talking to you. I appreciate you spending a little time with us. And we always enjoy seeing you here at the studio in Phoenix.
My pleasure, Rick. Thank you.
You know, I always think of Leslie Nielsen with the head of white hair and the kind of the tan, chiseled face, very kind of handsome man. The one photograph I had taken of him and me together in the studio, normally we didn't ask celebrities for photographs or autographs, but this time I made an exception. He had a full beard. He was working on a movie role. Didn't even look like himself. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.